know it's not actually until Thursday, but we are so glad to have you here. Welcome to our special Veterans Day service. We understand that all the freedoms we enjoy this morning, especially our freedom to assemble and worship, have been preserved by our men and women in the military.
Amen.
The Lord has used them, their willingness to fight and lose their lives during World War I, World War II, and all the other wars we had to fight after that, to fight to preserve the freedom we all enjoy this morning. So we're going to honor our veterans today, but before we start that, let's all stand and just greet one another, and then we'll get started.
Good morning. My name is Fred Smyan. I am a veteran. I'm also a pro member of our SEP team, both security and medical. I served in the Marines from 1966. See my photo out there. I was a young 18-year-old that time. I quit college to join the Marines, and I served from, 1966 to 1975. 4.5 years active, 4.5 years inactive. I was retired disabled. I was wounded in Vietnam twice. I was a combat vet, and went to Vietnam in 1966 or 67, was called to go back because of the Tet Offense in 1968. In 1968, December, I was wounded twice. I honor all vets who are serving, that have served, and we serve for a reason and for a cause. Again, I thank all vets. I'd like to have you join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. Please stand.
Because in 29 years of service, we had 13 moves.
And during that 29 years, I spent 3 years serving in the Pentagon. And after I retired, I became a consultant to the Air Force. I was in the Pentagon another 9 years after that. Believe me, not a place you want to spend 12 years, but that's how it worked out. So why do veterans serve? First, let me thank the church and the pastor for recognizing our veterans today. Why do we serve? We serve because we take an oath that we will support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic. And if you listen to when the president's sworn in, or senators and congressmen, almost any federal position, that's what they pledge to do. We're not supporting just the land or a person. We support an idea, and that's essentially what the United States is, an idea. And so we protect, support, and defend the Constitution of the United States. In the Pentagon, I think it was very interesting. When I first got stationed there, it was a very very kind of Spartan building. It's a huge building. It's a very Spartan building, very industrial in style, except for one area where the big guys live, okay? So where the Secretary of Defense and the Service Chiefs lived, it was a little more spruced up. And in particular, there was a stairway that goes up to the Secretary of Defense's office. And on the third floor of that stairway, there's a beautiful painting, and it's of a serviceman kneeling in prayer with his family. And they have a quote underneath that that comes from Scripture, from Isaiah chapter 6, verse 8, when Isaiah is getting his commission from the Lord. "Also I heard the voice of the Lord saying, 'Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?' And then I said, 'Here am I, send me.'" This is what our veterans did. They said, "Here am I, send me." So let me read a poem by a veteran, Dennis O'Brien of the United States Marine Corps, called The Soldier. "It is the soldier, not the reporter, who has given us freedom of the press. It is the soldier, not the poet, who has given us freedom of speech. It is the soldier, not the campus organizer, who has given us the freedom to demonstrate. It's the soldier, not the lawyer, who has given us the right to a fair trial. It's the soldier who salutes the flag, serves under the flag, and whose coffin is draped by the flag, who gives the protester the right to burn the flag."
Was a missile launch officer with Minuteman 1 missiles. And it's amazing how the Lord brings us together when we don't expect it. My wife was also, Shayla was also in the Air Force. She was from Chicago, I was from Los Angeles, and we met 60 feet underground at a launch control center near Cheyenne. Praise the Lord. Would you please stand for the reading of the scripture? Psalm 144, verses 1 and 2, and I'll read them both. "Blessed be the Lord my rock, who trains my hands for war and my fingers for battle.
Church. I'm also a retired Marine, served 3 tours in the Vietnam War area. My father was a World War II Marine and also Korea. I have a son in the back who also was a Marine who went to the first Gulf War. So you kind of say we are kind of prejudiced towards the Marines a little bit, but we're all in this together. Would you bow your head for prayer? Dear Lord, today we honor our veterans, worthy men and women who gave their best when they were called on to serve and protect our country. We pray that you will bless them, Lord, for their unselfish service, for the struggle to preserve our freedom, our safety, and our country. Bless them abundantly, Lord. We respect them, we love them, we thank them from the bottom of our hearts for the hardships they face. We honor them, we are proud of them for the sacrifices they and their families have made, and we pray that you will watch over each and every one of them. These Marines, airmen, sailors, and soldiers are very special in our hearts and very dear to us. Bless them with peace and happiness. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Please join me in singing My Country Tis of Me. He became a first lieutenant flying C-47 transport planes, and he trained pilots to fly B-52 bombers while serving in the European theater in Italy from 1944 to 1945. He was honorably discharged in 1947. And I just told you wrong, I said B-52s, it was B-25s. Captain Tuck received the Congressional Gold Medal this past June for being a Chinese-American World War II veteran. Over 20,000 Chinese-Americans served during World War II. Tuck was one of four living veterans that received the medal in Fresno at the young age of 98. But we just learned he recently had a birthday. He's 99 now.
To recognize all of our veterans, but first of all, we'd like to start with our combat veterans. If you are a combat veteran, would you please stand and come to the front and stand down here on either side of the Lord's Supper table, please, so that we can recognize you. Combat veterans. All right, and in the first service, we had a whole other group of them. We have quite a few in our church. All right, let's honor them. Let's like to recognize all of our veterans. So if you are any kind of military veteran, would you come up and stand alongside these others, please? We'd like to recognize, thank, and honor you also. I don't know if you noticed at the beginning, we played all your songs. I love all those military songs. It was very exciting. Okay, let's show them our gratitude.
Good morning, my name is Wayne Strickland. I served in the Marine Corps from 1988 to 1995. I served in combat in the first Persian Gulf War. Taps was played to let the soldiers know it was the end of the day, a signal light sound dating back to the Civil War. It officially became known as extinguished lights in American military manuals until 1891. Taps was played for the first time at a military funeral for a Union cannoneer killed in action. The man's commanding officer, Captain John Tidball, decided the bugle call would be safer than the traditional firing of three rifle volleys over the soldier's grave, a move which could be confused by the nearby enemy as an attack. Since that time, TAPS also has been a formally recognized part of U.S. military funerals. Perhaps more tears have been shed at the sound of TAPS than any other song in American history. It vividly brings to mind the patriotism, heroism, and the ultimate sacrifice of those that have fought for and died in defense of our country and the freedoms of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness for every American. TAPS is what Veterans Day is all about. Will you please remain standing for the playing of TAPS?
For many today, their heroes are heroes on the battlefield of sports. But the Bible gives us many examples of heroes. In Hebrews chapter 11, we have what is called the roll call of faith, heroes of the faith. But when we read their stories, they weren't just passive heroes who had great faith. Many of them were engaged in active battles in and for life, battles that involved bloodshed and killing. Hebrews 11:32 says this about them. And what shall I say? I do not have time to tell about Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, David, Samuel, and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, and gained what was promised, who shut the mouths of lions, quenched the fury of the flames, and escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned to strength, and who became powerful in battle. Excuse me. And routed foreign enemies, foreign armies. Today we are celebrating Veterans Day. The post office will be closed this Thursday. But it is a day that many churches often neglect. We can easily dismiss it as a secular holiday. In 1938, the 11th of November of each year, it became a legal holiday. It was a day dedicated to the cause of world peace, and to be hereafter celebrated and known as Armistice Day. Armistice Day was primarily a day set aside to honor veterans of World War I. That is, celebrating the time the agreement to end World War was signed. But in 1954, the wording was changed to Veterans Day, and November 11th became a day to honor all American veterans of all wars. And at FBC, we are more than happy to honor all our armed service veterans.
Amen.
And I believe they deserve recognition and honor, both combat and non-combat veterans. And as a nation, we honor our veterans Thursday. But again, many churches often fail to think about their veterans. After all, they say, if God thought about honoring veterans was important, why isn't there anything in the Bible about it? The answer to that is simple. There is. There are several places in the Bible that speaks about honoring warriors who fight in battle. And our passage this morning, 2 Samuel chapter 23, is one of them. When we turn to the scriptures today, we often read it through our politically correct, sanitized, and crazy culture. And we downplay the things that aren't part of our lives. And then much of the love we hear about today is a sweet, syrupy, no justice, all mercy kind of law that lets criminals go free and punishes the victims. I was reading famous quotes this past week. Leonardo da Vinci said in AD 1480, "He who does not punish evil commands it to be done." Is that not our political leaders today? They are passing laws that allow shoplifting up to $900, no cash bail, defund the police. Now I know we have Democrats in this church, and I love them, but I also know that they are not that kind of Democrat. I know this, it breaks their heart that the Democrat Party they love has devolved into the mess we see today. They went so far left, they lost their brains, they lost their minds. It's almost like law and order are two things to get rid of. And yet there is no civil society without law and order. It's unbelievable what these Democrats will do and say. And people believe them and follow them and vote for them. Someone said last week, Satan has been let loose. I agree. After this sermon today, I might get shot. Here's why. Because we don't hear sermons that show us why we should go to war. You just don't hear that today. sermons that point out the benefits of war. As we read through the Bible, both the Old and New Testament, it's hard to ignore all the fighting, war, and bloodshed. The easy thing for us to say today is God is love. And we need to love everyone, that is true. But sometimes the most loving thing to do is to fight.
Amen.
Well, our God is a God of love. He is also a God of war. And that is something that many Christians find hard to accept. They forget about the battle of Armageddon that is coming our way. And it is a battle that God himself is going to fight. And billions of people will die and go in hell. Listen to this passage in Psalm 144:1. Praise be to the Lord my rock, who trains my hands for war, my fingers for battle. When we read this Psalm of David, we can get conflicted inside. To think that our loving God gives us skill in fighting and war. After all, is war okay? Or should we be pacifists and never fight? To consider being a pacifist, we need to remember some other things that David said in Psalm 144. In verse 2 he says, He is my loving God, my fortress, my stronghold, and my deliverer, my shield, in whom I take refuge. David looks to God as his shield, as his refuge in times of war. Psalm 144, 6 and 7. David looks to God for deliverance during this war. Look there. Flash forth lightning and scatter them. Shoot out your arrows and destroy them. Stretch out your hand above. Rescue me and deliver me out of great waters from the hand of the foreigners or the invaders. But key to consider, the key is in verse 12, 13, and 14. And it's the reason for war. And if you don't get anything else out of this sermon, take this home with you. Here's why we go to war as Christians. That our sons may be as plants grown up in their youth. That our daughters may be as pillars sculptured in Palestine. That our barns may be full, supplying all kinds of produce. That our sheep may bring forth thousands and ten thousands in our fields. That our oxen may be well laden. That there be no breaking in or going out. That there be no outcry in our streets. David sees war as a means of protecting the safety of his family, of his country, of his people. And that is exactly why we as Christians are willing to fight. We do it for our kids and our grandkids, for our God and our country. And for those of you here this morning that do not like what I'm saying, you are benefiting from the blood that was shed for your freedom.
Amen. Come on.
In this church, somebody died for you to be here this morning. Look there at our passage this morning. David fought in wars to keep from having Jerusalem overrun, families taken to prison, to stop the distress and turmoil in their country. So as we consider the war, consider war and the role God, godly men and women play in it, look at this passage, 2 Samuel, chapter 23, verses 8 through 12. It's about David's mighty men. He's talking about veterans of the war. Verse 8, these are the names of the mighty men whom David had. JB the Tachmonite, chief among the captains. He was also called Adino the Isnite because he had killed 800 men at one time. And after him was Eleazar, the son of Dodo the Ahite, one of the three mighty men with David when they defied the Philistines who were gathered there for battle. And the men of Israel had retreated. He arose and attacked the Philistines until his hand was weary, and his hand stuck to the sword. The Lord brought about a great victory that day, and the people returned after him only to plunder. And after him was Shammah, the son of Agee, the Hararite. The Philistines had gathered together into a troop, for there was a piece of ground full of lentils. So the people fled from the Philistines. But he stationed himself in the middle of the field, defended it, and killed the Philistines. So the Lord brought about a great victory. And if you were to read the rest of the chapter, you will find a list of names and exploits of many more veterans of David's army. So why does David have to fight against the Philistines, the Amorites, the Canaanites, and all the otherites? Because his forefathers failed to fight when they had the chance. If you remember the story of the children of Israel wandering in the desert, told to go in and take Canaan and destroy the people, the Lord said, it is on account of the wickedness of these nations that the Lord is going to drive them out before the Israelites. The Bible says it is not because of your righteousness and your integrity that you are going in to take possession of the land, but on account of the wickedness of these nations. The Lord your God will drive them out before you to accomplish what he swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So the Jews were to go to war with them, actually to wipe them out completely. Deuteronomy 20:14 tells us why. Because they will teach you to follow all the detestable things they do and worshiping their gods. And you will sin against the Lord your God. But the Jews failed to carry out God's commands. And as a result, their enemies lived on as a thorn in their side. And you can read about it in the book of Judges, where they led God's people into deep sin. And just so again, the Jews in Joshua's day failed to fight the battle completely. They failed to drive out them as God had told them to. And we see the same thing sometimes in American history. Many times we fight wars, but not to win them. And so our enemies come back years later and harm us. The great five-star general, Douglas MacArthur, wanted to continue the Korean War and finish China while they were weak. He said, if we don't, we'll have to fight them again. And Harry Truman, the President of the United States, fired him. Four-star General George W. Patton didn't want to end World War II with the defeat of Germany, but he wanted to go forward and take on the Red Menace, Russia. And our government silenced George Patton. We totally defeated Germany and Japan in World War II, and today they are our allies. And yet 60 to 80 years later, China and Russia are still our mortal enemies. And what they believe has infiltrated the very fabric of our society. Godless socialists and Christ-denying communists are being elected to the United States House of Representatives, the United States Senate. And many Americans, some call themselves Christians, believe godless socialism is good and Christ-centered capitalism is bad. How in the world can that be? How sad is that? So it comes down to David, a man after God's own heart. David fights valiantly for his people. He fights so his nation will be able to enjoy peace. David's legacy that he left to his son Solomon was to inherit a kingdom that had peace on every side. But I want you to know, peace doesn't come without a price. It takes warfare and bloodshed. David was a charismatic leader. Men loved him. They loved to be with him. They wanted to join him and follow him. He had many valiant warriors. And God enshrines forever in his word the names and exploits of many of them. So I ask, why would God record this list of veterans? I answer, for our encouragement. He wants us to learn from something from them. He wants us to learn from their example. This morning, very briefly, there are four things to remember about Veterans Day. First, remember the price of freedom. Valiant warriors do not fight for the sake of killing. They don't fight for rewards. They fight for their country's freedom. They fight for their family's safety and their fellow Americans. There is a cause when we go to war. Remember the tens of thousands of Americans that signed up to fight after 9/11. Muslim extremists killed 3,000 innocent Americans. The same thing happened after Japan unprovoked bombed Pearl Harbor. My point is, there is a reason to go to war. If you remember the story of David and Goliath, Goliath has been out there for 40 days wanting and waiting for a fight. Saul had offered anyone who would fight him great wealth. He said if anybody who would fight him could marry into the royal family, that person and their families wouldn't have to pay taxes for the rest of their life, but no one would fight. Christian men don't fight for money. But do you remember what David says? He hears Goliath blaspheming God, and David knows he needs to do something. The old King James Version records David saying, "Is there not a cause?" The story in 1 Samuel 17:4 is our record to tell us what David says to Goliath. And this definitely is not politically correct. "You come against me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will hand you over to me, and I will strike you down and cut off your head. Today I will give the carcasses of the Philistine army to the birds of the air and the beasts of the earth, and the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel." You know, when I read verses like that, it makes me want to do something great for God, great for our country. Why does he fight? Because there was a cause. He stands up for the name of the Lord Almighty, so the whole world would know that there's a God in Israel. Why do we fight today? Listen, we don't fight for the sake of war. We fight for the sake of freedom. The freedoms our God has given us. And so as we honor our veterans today, we need to remember that they paid the price to preserve our God-given freedoms for us. Freedom is never free. So what do we learn from Veterans Day? We learn to remember the price of freedom. Second, we learn to honor those who fought for our God-given freedoms. If you look here at 2 Samuel 23, verse 18, "Now Abishai, the brother of Joab, the son of Zeruiah, was chief of another three. He lifted his spear against 300 men, killed them, and won a name among these three." And verse 19 says he was held in greater honor than the three. Matter of fact, it says he became their commander. Now notice what was given in response to these veterans. They received honor. Today we think about veterans. We're not just thankful. We're very thankful for their service. I would encourage you to consider always doing that. That's the basic, the least thing we can do is just personally thank them. And then, how about when you go to a cemetery? Why not drop a flower off at a veteran's cemetery at their gravesite? It shows you appreciate them dying, serving their country. And then stand for our national anthem. Nothing is more disrespectful or disgraceful than not standing for it. Or maybe God is leading you to do something more, such as becoming a member of our military. But think about how you can honor our veterans. So remember them, honor them, And then lastly, learn from their example. As we look at the veterans here in 2 Samuel 23, we learn that we need to take a stand and stand our ground. We don't run from a fight, but we don't run to one. If there's trouble and we're there, we take our stand, regardless of the opposition. The way we left Afghanistan made every patriotic American sick in their heart and sick to their stomach. And in the years ahead, many of our grandchildren and our children will die because of what happened there. Look at verse 8. We see JB facing, fights 800-1 odds. What is that telling us? It's telling us that we take a stand when no one else will, no matter what the odds are. Verse 8, these are the names of the mighty men whom David had. BJ, the Tachmonite, JB, chief among the captains. He was also called Adina, Desnite, because he had killed 800 men at one time. Verse 9 and 10, we see Eleazar. He fought so long that his hand froze to his sword. He had gripped his sword for so long and so hard he couldn't open his hand. If you've ever used a hammer all day, then you know what I'm talking about. Verse 10. He arose and attacked the Philistines until his hand was weary and his hand stuck to the sword. Verse 11, we see Shammah, who draws a line in a pea patch and says no further. Verse 11, after him was Shammah, the son of Agee, the Hararite. The Philistines had gathered together into a troop, for there was a piece of ground full of lentils. There was a garden of peas and beans. So the people fled from the Philistines. Even though all his fellow soldiers ran, Shammah stood his ground. We need to learn to stand our ground, regardless of the situation. We Christians, I know you might think I'm an extremist here, but I'm not. But we Christians are in a war for the soul of this country.
Yes.
We are. And I, for one, am not going down fighting. And I'm not changing. I promise you, I'm going to preach this word till God takes me out of this pulpit.
Amen.
Amen. We're going to take our stand and for what is right. And we have examples right here in the Word of God. Mighty men and women in the Bible. No retreat, no regrets, no surrender. They serve faithfully their King and their God. Now, one more thing I want you to consider today. Soldiers do not fight their battle alone. Even though we stay home, we can have a part in the battle. We can pray for those in harm's way. We believe God hears and answers prayer.
Yes.
And so we cry out to God for his help in protecting those who are fighting to protect us. In Psalm 144 is the psalm where David cries out to God for help in war. And verses 5, 6, and 7, that psalm, there's a beautiful reminder of what and the way we can pray for these brave men and women fighting for our country. Here's David's war prayer. And by the way, this is not politically correct. I was watching the pastor, I think Robert Jeffers, First Baptist Church, Dallas, Texas. And he was being interviewed. And the interviewer was a Christian. And she asked about our president. And he said, I am praying that God would remove him before he can do any more damage. Now, when he said that, that was not politically correct. She didn't know how to respond. Not at all. That's this prayer. When you take a stand for Christ, for God, it's not going to be politically correct. Look there. Part your heavens. Bow your heavens, O Lord, and come down. Touch the mountains so that they smoke. Send forth lightning and scatter the enemy. Shoot your arrows and rout them. Reach down your hand from on high. Deliver and rescue from the mighty waters, from the hands of foreigners. strange children. Is God moved to act when his people pray this way? Absolutely. Today we want to thank our veterans, our military veterans. We want to remember their service, honor them, learn from their example, standing their ground for what is right. You know, as pastor here at First Baptist Church of Sparks, I want us all to be proud of our veterans.
Amen.
And those that are serving in our military. Freedom is precious. A lot was shed for you to be here this morning. Maybe you never think about it. A lot of men and women died so we can enjoy what we're experiencing this morning. I'd like to close our services today and sing together our national anthem in honor of our country and the men and women who have fought and those who have died for the freedoms we have today. And Lori, when we're through, you make the announcements. I want to have a brief invitation. Let's stand and sing.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the red.